You're in the house with Jamerio.
Right here on AM 1100, Atlanta's entertainment radio network.
Some people live for the fortune. Some people live just for the fame. Some people live for the power, yeah. Some people live just to play the game. Some people think that the physical things define what's within, and I've been there before. That life's a bore, so full of the superficial. Search for a fountain. The promise is forever young. You know, some people need 3 dozen roses, and that's the only way to prove you love them. Hand me the world on a silver platter, and
in the house with Jamerio on Monday, 12 noon to 2 on 1100 AM.
You are back in the house with Jamerio, and this is David Jordan with today's Black History Moment. I need everybody to listen because we are going to talk about Black Wall Street. Black Wall Street is the name fittingly given to one of the most affluent all-black communities in America. It was bombed from the air and burned to the ground by mobs of envious whites. In a period spanning fewer than 12 hours, a once thriving business district in northern Tulsa, this is Oklahoma, lay smoldering. A model community destroyed and a major African-American movement resoundingly diffused. The night's carnage left some 3,000 African-Americans dead and over 600 successful businesses lost. Among these were 21 churches, 21 restaurants, 30 grocery stores, 2 movie theaters, plus a hospital, a bank, a post office, library, schools, law offices, and half a dozen private airplanes and even a bus system. As could have been expected, the impetus behind all of this was the infamous KKK working in consort with ranking city officials and many other sympathizers. Black America's most prosperous community, Black Wall Street in Tulsa, Oklahoma, went up in flames June 1st, 1921, in the KKK-led Tulsa race riot. According to Wikipedia, during the 16 hours of assault, over 800 people were admitted to local hospitals with injuries, and estimated 10,000 were left homeless. And 35 city blocks composed of 1,256 residences were destroyed by fire caused by bombing. The best description of Wall Street, or Little Africa as it was also known, would be to compare it to a mini Beverly Hills. It was the golden door of the black community during the 1900s, and it proved that African Americans could create a successful infrastructure. That's what Black Wall Street was all about. The dollar circulated 36 to 100 times, sometimes taking a year for currency to leave the community. Now a dollar leaves the black community in 15 minutes. As for resources, there were PhDs residing in Little Africa, black attorneys, and doctors. One doctor was Dr. Berry, who owned the bus system. His average income was $500 a day, hefty pocket change in 1920. These are black built, but no, I'm going to skip that because I got to make this quicker. This was a time when the entire state of Oklahoma had only two airports, yet six blacks owned their own planes. It was a very fascinating community. The mainstay of the community was to educate every child. Nepotism was the one word they believed in, and that's what we need to get back to. The main thoroughfare was Greenwood Avenue. It was intersected by Archer and Pine Streets. From the first letters in each names, you get the word Gap. And that's where the renowned R&B music group, The Gap Band, got its name. They're from Tulsa, Oklahoma. This has been the Black History Moment, and you're in the house.
That was hot that day, boy. Yeah. You in deep on that, boy. Yeah. I mean, you in.
That's must-know stuff.
That's heavy stuff right there, man. Yeah. I'm like, Black
Wall Street.
Black Wall Street. Now, speaking of Black Wall Street and business, and we talking about love, I want to ask. This is something that's on my mind. Finance versus love. Why finance always the issue in a relationship and marriage? Because most relationships are destroyed because of finance.
Yeah.
And not love. So, I'm going to start with you, James. Uh-huh. How's your relationship with you and your wife? Is it based on finance or is it based on love? I'm being real. No, I mean, I'm just being real. Because we need to get this straight now. Because I had to explain to somebody. Got love, it's together. You know, don't worry about the finance. You don't have the finance. So they always come in there, finance. Well, finance ain't no romance. No, we got to get this love together.
Well, we love our finances. How about that?
Yeah.
I know you love your finances. We know she living nice.
I do think that a lot of people do, you know, find it out after they, you know, really get into a relationship with someone that, you know, starts out with love. I think that finances don't have anything to do with love initially.
Right.
You know, I think that a person sees a person, they really, you know, they're attracted to them and they fall in love.
Yeah.
You know, I think later on that with all the pressures of life, man, because, you know, without finances come pressure.
Yeah.
And pressure, you know, it takes a toll on a personal relationship.
Yeah.
You know, when you're dealing with something every day, you know, like you at the house, it's hard to hug and love somebody. They talking about turning your lights off in a few minutes.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? I mean, I don't know if I feel the same way about you that I did a few minutes ago. You know what I'm saying? While we sitting in this cold. So I'm just saying is that, you know, I'm just saying. So it's that type of thing. You know, it's hard to love somebody, hug on somebody when your stomach is growling. You know, it's just hard. You know, somebody just repossessed your car. I mean, I don't know if I feel the same way about you right now, like the earlier when I was rolling around.
Yeah.
So, you know, I think that's the real issue is that it's hard when you have those type of things to happen to you in your life. I mean, you have to react to that, and a lot of times it's not going to be love. You know what I'm saying? So
you don't mind me asking, how long have you and your wife been married?
Well, me and my wife been married actually about 26 years, but I've been with my wife though for about 35 years.
You know, we gonna put you and Pastor in first because they've been together for 30 years and they went to high school together.
Yeah, see, I met my wife
That's interesting. They're really supposed to been here. To do the segment about the relationship. I can't wait to get y'all together because they've been together. They together 24/7.
Yeah.
Every day, 24 every day. Sun up to sun down. They always together. Always. I'm his armor bearer, so they always together. Right. Always together. Are you and your wife like that all day?
Well, I mean, I love being around my wife because,
yeah.
you know, we have a great relationship. Like I said, obviously, you know, I've been with her since, you know, we were both teenagers, you know. So,
I can't wait to get y'all together. Oh, my goodness.
Same thing. Yeah.
Oh, y'all, we got to get y'all together because that's going to be, we got to make this happen. But y'all basically have nothing.
Oh, no. I mean, like, I'm from a small town, Mississippi, so, you know, you can just kind of imagine, you know, the humble beginning, you know, beginnings that we had. But what I'm saying is that, you know, but I grew up with my wife.
Yeah.
So, you know, so basically we're friends, you know, I mean.
Oh, my God.
I mean, you know, I've been knowing her since, you know, she was probably like 14 and I was, probably like, you know, 16 or 17. So I'm just saying is that we've been together that long.
Oh, my God. I can't wait for y'all to get together.
That's the same thing.
That's going to be hot. I know he listens to that, man. That you yeah. Oh, man, this is going to be hot. I mean, but this day and time, it's not like that.
What do you mean?
It's always about finance. Mm-hmm. It's like a woman, I would tell somebody, no woman don't want to be with a man if he ain't got it. Mm-hmm. And he's trying to get it. Mm-hmm. They're ready to be with somebody who already got it, and it's not no stress or right. No pressure.
Well, I mean, I think it's something that was taught. I mean, like, one thing is, like I explained to people, years ago, you know, it was very few people who had anything. So the choices was limited. So a lot of times you chose a person just on love. Now you see everybody has stuff. So it's like, you know, people get confused and start looking around. Well, I like this guy, but this guy has a little bit more. You know, so maybe, what about this guy? You know, what about this young lady? So it's just, there's so many things out there. I think it's confused. It's kind of like going to Cheesecake Factory.
Yeah.
You know, you have so many things on the menu, you get confused. You be just looking at the menu, man, sometimes 30 minutes trying to figure out, what do I get, you know? And it wasn't like that at one time. So now it's just so many choices. I think people just get confused. And so it's just, they just decide they just want to just put a thing on it. And the thing is let's find the one who got the most money and deal with that. That's the easiest route. Yeah. And I think that's what people do, you know? And that's not the answer, I don't think, you know? But that's.
Well, what about you, Dave? How did your wife come to y'all? Like you said earlier, she chose.
Because see, I told you she had vision. she had vision, and I think that's what people have to have. Because I didn't have two dimes to rub together when we got together, and she was okay, but I think she had vision. She knew that there was more to me, so I have exactly two dimes to rub together, and we're making it though.
Right.
See, that's
we really don't put emphasis on finances in our home. We really don't. Because there's so much going on with the kids, and we don't.
Y'all got some beautiful boy. Now, Austin, his baby boy, I can't wait to braid his hair. I got a new product.
He keep talking about
braiding. Roll his hair.
Let me know when you're going to do it. I'm cutting the ball.
I'm going to pull a dye hair. I'm going to bring him back as Busy Bone. But I have an issue with that with some women. I mean, now, when y'all both, you know, how long you been married now, Dave?
It's going on 7 years in April 29th.
Oh, yeah. Honeymoon coming up quick.
Mm. Yep.
The problem I have is that with me, if you ain't with me before I get it, you just out of luck. You know, I try to do things perfectly just to see where the woman's mind is.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
Just see, you know, where your goal is. You're going to really be with me when hard times really hard times.
Right.
Because that's when you know who that person is.
Right.
Absolutely.
You know, I mean, you know, don't wait till I get it. Then you come around to my, I want to talk to you. No, you don't.
Right.
Yeah.
No, you don't. But with that said, had God in the marriage, or you know, how did y'all came in together? Was God there?
Well, when I first met my wife, God wasn't in my life. She actually introduced me to God, so you know.
Oh, why do you say what?
But I'm just saying. But, you know, so
I didn't introduce you to God.
Absolutely.
Okay, you know, this is interesting. I'm going to say when we get ready to take a break. It's women at church dating men that's not into God, and sleeping with them, And I don't know. I don't know. I ain't saying the church is it, but most women who see somebody they like, they feel like I can get them in God. But what she do to get you into God? I mean, what was it? Because these Negroes don't come to the church.
Well.
These Negroes, I don't know what's going on. I mean, these some good attractive women. I don't even bother with them. I just leave them alone because I got my own issue.
Well, I think it was pretty simple. She said, I ain't going to be with you unless you find God. So, you know. So, I mean, I was like, oh, okay.
How long did it take you to find some God?
Right away. What you doing this evening? We going to try to see if we can find him now.
Hey, you in the house with Jamario. We're going to take a break. We'll be right back.